We were discussing about tympanoplasty. In tympanoplasty part 1, I talked about the indications, contraindications, the pre-op preparation, and also the types of tympanoplasty. The link is given here. And part 2 discussed on the general tips of tympanoplasty and also the incisions and approaches. Here it is given. In this part, I'll describe on type 1 tympanoplasty or the meningoplasty, the indications, contraindication, and the graft materials used, and also the types, two different types, mainly the overlay and also the underlay. I have written two terms here, meningoplasty and type 1 tympanoplasty. Is it the same? There is a basic difference between these two. In meningoplasty, we are simply repairing the tympanic membrane perforation. And if along with meningoplasty, if we are looking or inspecting the middle ear, inspection, then it becomes type 1 tympanoplasty. The procedure we are doing is, in both cases we are repairing the tympanic membrane perforation, but if along with that, if we are inspecting the middle ear for looking for any disease in the middle ear, any ossicular discontinuity, then it becomes type 1 tympanoplasty. So for any surgical procedure, it has to be dealt under the headings of indication, contraindication, prerequisites if any, then what, the position, then anesthesia, the steps of surgery, the post-operative care, and the complications. It should be done or written under these 8 headings. Okay. Yeah. The indications of type 1 tympanoplasty is very clear. That is the perforation of the tympanic membrane. Okay. If this is a tympanic membrane, this is external auditory canal, and this is a medullary part. So a perforation of the tympanic membrane. So that is an indication. And contraindication, acute infections, all non-specific infections, active infections of the middle ear, external auditory canal, and also specific infections like tuberculosis and also the malignancies. They are the contraindication. Mainly a non-specific and specific infection and also malignancy. And before going to the steps, I'll explain some basic concepts. What are the layers of tympanic membrane? It was already discussed in anatomy of tympanic membrane. I'll summarize it here. There are 3 layers for tympanic membrane. The first layer is obviously continuation of external auditory canal, that is the squamous epithelium. Okay, this is external auditory canal, squamous epithelium, epithelial layer. Okay. And inside the epithelial layer comes the inner fibrous layer. This is a fibrous layer, which is again divided into radial and circular fibers. And the innermost is the mucosal layer, which is continuous with that of the middle ear mucosa. Okay. Innermost or the medial. Okay. So, of the 3 layers, outer squamous epithelium, inner fibrous, middle fibrous layer, and the inner mucosal layer, and of the 3, only the squamous epithelium has got the property to grow. Okay, so this squamous epithelium will always, it is growing, it will keep on growing, even if there is a perforation. See, this is a perforation. Even if this there is a perforation, what will happen? This will grow, 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 grow. And it will grow towards the under surface. Okay, here also it will grow towards the under surface, and some of this will grow and fall off into the middle ear also. That is the basic pathology of a secondary acute cholesteatoma, which was already discussed along in the class of cholesteatoma. The link is given there. So actually, if this is a perforation and this is a lateral surface, the squamous epithelium will grow from here and it will grow, either it will fall off into the middle layer or it will grow through the under surface into the middle layer. So that is why the first step of meningoplasty is always freshening of the rim. Okay, freshen the rim. We will make a cut here. This part is removed, and also with a scraper, we will scrape the under surface. Okay, this under surface is also cleared. So if any squamous epithelium is there, it is also scraped off. So after freshening of the rim and scraping of the under surface, the perforation will be like this. So if we are keeping a graft, think as if we are keeping an underlay grafting. This black is the graft. So that what will happen? This will act as a scaffold. This graft will act as a scaffold. Okay. For the squamous epithelium to grow over that. So that this squamous epithelium will grow over that, will grow over that, will grow over that. And over a period of time, this perforation is closed. Okay, so that is the basis of meningoplasty or a type 1 tympanoplasty. Now the whole thing becomes very easy, isn't it? So what we are doing in a meningoplasty or a type 1 tympanoplasty? First we are freshening the rim of perforation. Then we are scraping the undersurface of perforation. And we are giving a graft. So that this squamous epithelium will grow over that. And over a period of time, this entire perforation is closed. Very easy. Okay. Now the thing happens, what are the prerequisites? So these are the prerequisites. So it should be a central perforation for at least, and it should be dry. For tympanoplasty, even if it is not dry, we can look into the middle ear, and if we can remove any cholesteatoma, if any there. But a cholesteatoma is a contraindication for a type 1 tympanoplasty alone or a meningoplasty. Okay. So it should be dry for at least 4 to 6 weeks. And middle ear mucosa should be normal. If there is any granulation tissue or any other disease in the middle ear mucosa, that is a contraindication. And again, the ocellular chain should be intact. Why? If suppose a condition where the patient is having a perforation like this, and also there is an ossicular discontinuity. So what will be the hearing loss for the patient? It will be around 40 to 50 dB, isn't it? It was already explained along with the part 1 of tympanoplasty. And there is a ossicular discontinuity, and also there is a perforation. And think of a scenario in which we are not looking into the ossicular discontinuity. We are repairing this tympanic membrane perforation alone. What will happen with an ossicular discontinuity, with the intact tympanic membrane? Will the hearing loss will worsen or will improve? Definitely it will worsen. If you make the tympanic membrane perforation too close with an ossicular discontinuity, the loss will be around 60 dB. So that will be a grave situation, isn't it? So that is another prerequisite. The ossicular chain should be intact. Then good cochlear reserve. What does it mean? The patient should not have any sensory neural hearing loss. If there is a sensory neural hearing loss and you are repairing the tympanic membrane, again, there won't be any improvement. Okay. And the patent eustachian tube. Because the middle ear should have an adequate aeration. So if the eustachian tube is not functioning normally, or if it is not patent, again the whole thing will be in vain. And there should be no focus of infection in nose, paranasal sinus and nasopharynx. So these six prerequisites should be satisfied before going for a meningoplasty. The preoperative preparation or preoperative evaluation is the same as that of tympanoplasty, was already discussed. And also we discussed the anesthesia and the positioning of the patient in part 1 of tympanoplasty. And next comes the harvesting of the graft material. So because we have to put a graft for the squamous epithelium to grow. So graft materials are important. Autograft, auto from same person. I am taking my own temporalis fascia for grafting. Then it becomes an autograft. Isograft, identical twins. Okay, graft taken from identical twins. Then homograft, what is that? I am taking a graft for my thymeroplasty. I am taking from your temporalis fascia. Okay, then it becomes a homograft of the same species. Then heterograft, what is that? For my thymeroplasty, I am taking the graft from my pet dog. Then it becomes a heterograft. Okay, of different species. Right? So, of these, which graft is the better one, best one? No doubt, it is the autograft. From my own. That is autograft. Why it is preferred? Because there is no chance of immunological reaction. There is no chance of spread of infection like HIV, especially this HIV and slow virus infections like Kuru. It may spread through a graft material. So there is no chance of such a spread. And also if it is inexpensive and easy to get. Okay, so that is why we prefer always an autograft is preferred. No immunological reaction. No chance of infection spread, especially the slow virus infections and HIV. Inexpensive and easy to get. Okay, so of this autograft, there are so many autografts available. These are the commonly used autograft. They are the temporalis fascia, which is the most preferred one. Then the perichondrium and cartilage. From which part? Commonly from the tragus and also from the concha. So congal or trigal, perichondrium, and also cartilage. Then vein, fat, especially of the ear lobule, fat granule, and also the fascia lata. And of this temporalis fascia, perichondrium, then cartilage and the fascia lata are mesodermal in origin, and there is low risk of iatrogenic cholesteatoma formation. And why this temporalis fascia is preferred? What are the advantages over other this thing? Because one, you know, the temporalis fascia is in the same surgical plane. If you are doing a thymeroplasty inside the ear, this can be done through the same incision sometime. Endoral or the postural incision can be extended to harvest that. So it comes in the same surgical field. And second, that is low basal metabolic rate, low BMR, so that the less nutrition is needed and also the chance of survival is very high. So the success rate for temporalis fascia is around, take up rate is around 93% to 97% in the best hands. Okay, that varies with the surgeon. And the fourth one is, there is no limit, it can be a very large graft can be taken. So this can be, because there is enough graft materials, enough availability, this can be used for the sandwich procedures or multiple layering of the graft. For all that kind of procedures, this temporalis fascia can be used. And also it is easy to harvest. So the same surgical field, easy to harvest, low BMR, high success rate, and also enough material is available. Large surface area can be harvested. Because of all that, we prefer temporalis fascia. But there are also some disadvantages. One, it lacks elasticity, and also there is no tolerance to pressure changes in the external rotary canal. And second, eventually it becomes thin and atrophic. So these are the two disadvantages of temporalis fascia graft. There is always a debate between this facial graft and the cartilaginous graft. Regarding the superiority, which one is superior to other, and there are lots of studies regarding the superiority of all this, and in some study there is a statistically significant difference, that is the cartilage graft is superior to facial graft, but in all the study there is no statistical association or superiority between these facial graft and the cartilaginous graft. But there are some advantages of the cartilage graft over the facial graft. Mainly the cartilage graft is resistant, it is elastic and also resistant to pressure changes in the external auditory canal, that is number one. Second, it is more resistant to infection, and the long term survival of the cartilage graft is superior to that of facial graft. So it's more elastic and resistant to pressure changes in the external auditory canal. Second, resistant to infection. And third, long term survival rate of cartilage graft is more than that of facial graft. You harvested the graft. Next is exposure of the drum head. If the canal is very wide, permeatal tympanum incision, Rosen's incision can be done. And if the canal is narrow, then go through a postoral incision, and then postoral William Weil's approach can be used. And in some cases, whatever you do, there will be a bulge from the anterior canal wall, obscuring the view of the anteriormost part of the tympanic membrane. And in that cases, if you do that, the positioning of the graft on the anterior part will be difficult, and it may end up in a perforation in the anterior part of the tympanic membrane. And if so, it is better to elevate a flap called a right gill fold. Elevate this gill fold flap, and by elevating this flap, it will be easy to approach the anteriormost part of the drum. And after that, second is the preparation of the drum head, that was already discussed, that is the freshening of the rim and also scraping the undersurface of the tympanic membrane. And the third is the positioning of the graft. This positioning can be either it can be lateral to the tympanic membrane, or it can be medial to the tympanic membrane. And so it becomes an underlay grafting, or can be an overlay grafting. Okay. Some textbooks describe an interlay also. Postgraduate should prepare on interlay grafting grafting technique. Underlay technique is preferred, and I think it is a commonly done procedure. And here the graft material is kept. This is the black is the graft material. It is kept medial to the tympanic membrane towards the medullary side. This is the medullary and this is the external auditory canal. So the approach is already described in tympanoplasty part 2. Can be either a lateral tympanotomy approach, or you can go through a posterior Weil's postoral approach. In any case, this annulus is elevated from 6 o'clock to 12 o'clock, and the graft is kept through the elevated flap medial to the tympanic membrane. And in this case, the care should be taken not to injure the mucosa of the especially the promontory on the medial wall of medullary. Because if there is raw area on the medial wall, there is chance that this graft can come and fall or adhere to the medial wall. So that is a disadvantage. Okay. And keeping this graft, the in between we keep a gel form also. Here gel form, either a plain gel form or dipped in antibiotic solutions can be kept between the medial wall and the graft material, and replace the tympanometal flap. And again, this external artery canal is packed with a gel form with ointment. And the advantages are, this method is simple and easy, and we are not doing more extensive dissection on the anterior wall. You know that it is from 6 o'clock to, if the patient is lying down, This is 12 o'clock. So from 6 o'clock to 12 o'clock, we are elevating the tympanometer flap. There is no excessive dissection of the anterior wall. So it will prevent, there is no chance of blending of the anterior recess. What is this anterior recess? This part is the anterior recess, this area. This area. This is the anterior recess. So if we are elevating dissecting the anterior wall, there is chance of blending of this anterior recess. That is not there in underlay technique. And healing occurs at the correct level relative to the annulus and the ossicles. That is also an advantage. Actually, we are keeping the graft even medial to the handle of malleus. Okay, so there is less chance of extrusion of the graft. And the disadvantages, one thing I already told, if this graft is falling into the middle ear or the medial wall, the middle ear space can get narrowed. That is one disadvantage. And the second one, if the perforation is too anterior, it is difficult to do the grafting through this underlay technique. And the third, there is more chance of formation of an anterior tympanometer cholesteatoma also. These are the disadvantages. The other technique is the overlay technique. As the name suggests, the tympanic the graft is kept over the tympanic membrane. So from this you can know that you can see that this external auditory canal lined by squamous epithelium, and that is combined with the or continuous with the squamous epithelial layer of the tympanic membrane, isn't it? So in overlay technique, we are elevating the squamous epithelial layer of the tympanic membrane along with that of the external auditory canal, and the graft is placed between this epithelial layer and fibrous layer. See, it is kept here. Okay. Right. So the graft is kept lateral to the tympanic membrane, fibrous layer, between the squamous epithelium and the fibrous layer. So for that we need a superiorly placed vascular strip incision, that is incision from the tympanosquamous and tympanomastoid suture line along the suture line at the bony cartilaginous junction, and it is elevated, and after that whatever the graft, or if it is temporalis fasciae graft, it is kept here. Okay, kept over this, and this flap is replaced. The incision will be like this, isn't it? So it is suited for large perforations, and also this is the anterior part. So anterior perforations, this overlay is the ideal one, and also for revision surgery, it is better to go for an overlay technique. And this overlay technique has got disadvantages also. One is that, you know, we are keeping it lateral to the handle of malleus. So chance of lateralization of the graft. In underlay technique, the chance of this graft falling into the promoter is high. Like that, lateralization of the graft is more in case of an overlay. And to reduce that lateralization, in the graft, make a, if this is a graft, you make a slit in the graft and put it or tuck it into the or below the, underneath the handle of malleus. So that graft will stay in place. So lateralization of the graft will be reduced by doing this technique. That is one. And another disadvantage is that blending of the anterior recess. This is the anterior recess. See, on the anteriormost part. And we are keeping the elevating, and there is chance of blending. This will go. So what will happen if there is blending? The tympanic membrane vibrating, surface area will be reduced. So there is chance of a conductive hearing loss. So one is lateralization of the graft. Second is blending of the anterior recess. And the third is we are keeping the graft between this squamous layer and the fibrous layer. So there is chance of an iatrogenic cholesteatoma formation. And this is technically more challenging, time consuming and difficult to do than an underlay technique. So the advantages are, it is best suited for an anterior perforation, large perforations, revision surgeries, and the healing rate is high compared to an underlay. But the disadvantages are, one is blunting of the anterior recess, lateralization of the graft, chance of formation of iatrogenic cholesteatoma, and the healing time is longer and technically difficult to procedure, and expertise is much more of expertise is needed. So these are the two techniques, that is the underlay and the overlay. Other than this, if you are not using temporalis facial graft, this cartilage graft can also be used in the same method, like in island flaps are there, shield method. That is, if it is a cartilage, if you are putting in wedge to fit into the handle of malleus, and this is called the shield technique of cartilage grafting. Then palisade means palisading, small pieces of cartilage put together of the graft, and also there are inlay butterfly technique of cartilage grafting. The patient is advised not to blow the nose and also to avoid forceful sneezing, avoid entry of water into the ear, then not allowed to go to gym minimum of 6 to 12 weeks and also avoid flight. All those which causes increase in the intrathoracic pressure and also increase in the middle ear pressure is avoid. The tuniforme test is done on the first post-op day once the patient is completely out of anesthesia. Mastoid dressings can be removed in 24 to 48 hours and healing and any chance of infection is noted. The stitches are removed on 5 to 7 days. And after 3 weeks, the patient is again assessed under microscope. Look for the neovascularization and condition of the TM flap. If there is any granulation tissue, that should be removed. There is chance of granulation tissue formation along the TM flap. If it is present, it should be removed. And also the canal is cleaned from any clot or any remaining ear pack. And the PTA is done usually after 6 to 12 weeks. So this is in nutshell around about type 1 temporoplasty or meningoplasty. I told about the different graft materials used and the underlay and the overlay technique, the advantages or disadvantages of each technique, and also the different type of cartilage which can be used for grafting, and also the post-operative care. Okay, thank you.